yesterday, Rabbi. Sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs, redemption songs.
There's one thing which touches every corner of the Caribbean: slavery. Everyone here is the child of that experience.
On the 1st of August, another runaway caught. Put him in the bilboes, both feet, gagged him, locked his hands together, rubbed him with molasses, and exposed him naked to the flies all day and to the mosquitoes all night. Two others got away.
Those words came from the diary of a young Englishman who kept slaves in Jamaica in the 18th century. On a plantation very much like this one. Although the English liberals led the campaign to abolish slavery, the British were the people who, more than any other, made slavery into a prosperous, thriving business. And both sides of that coin are Britain's legacy to these islands.
For four centuries, the European powers fought each other bitterly for possession of these islands. The British presence started with pirates looking in these inlets for hiding places from which to attack the Spanish treasure ships. In 1655, the British formally occupied the island. Settlers soon followed, and by the 1760s, Jamaica had 680 sugar estates. Typically, the British planter's elegant home was flanked by an overseer's house, surrounded in turn by slave quarters. Slaves in those days outnumbered whites on Jamaica by 9 to 1.
Life was pretty grim for those early settlers. The towns were hot and dirty, full of gamblers and prostitutes and part-time buccaneers. According to one traveler, Jamaica was the dunghill of the universe. Into this frontier society was thrust a young man called Thomas Thistlewood when he arrived in Jamaica on the 23rd of April, 1750.
Thistlewood's diary of an overseer is fascinating because it provides a unique record of how whites treated blacks, a mixture of cruelty and intimacy which shapes their relationship to this day.
Monday, the 15th of July, 1765. Attended the Negro sale in the house in Savannah La Mar, where Jimmy Hayes formerly kept a tavern. A very unfair sale, as Mr. Salmon permitted Mr. Goodwin, Dr. Walker, and Bessie Murray to pick before the sale began. Besides this, above 20 of the best slaves were left aboard and picked out before they came ashore. In regard to buying Negroes, I would choose boys and girls not exceeding 16 and 18 years old, as full-grown men and women seldom turn out so well.
On this occasion, Thistlewood bought three slaves.
Cyfox, a Negro man about 19 or 20 years old. Kudrow, a man Caramante, about 20 years, 5'6", bow-shinned. Bristol, a boy, 5'1", Sakuk country, about 17 years. I feed my new Negroes 3 pints of rice each per diem. All were branded on the shoulder TT.
Slave women were required to submit to their master's sexual pleasure. Thistlewood obsessively recorded, partly in Latin, his daily demands of slaves like Fibber.
Come Fibber in boiling house, stands backwards, said non bene.
Said non bene, not too good that time.
Tuesday, 18th. Mr. John Cope and Mr. John Dorwood dined here and got very drunk. They had Eve and Margarita. It is said Mrs. Cope's waiting maid at Paradise Estate is with child, but whether from Mulatto Davy, her husband, or Mr. John Cope, in my opinion, is doubtful.
The planters inflicted obscene and degrading punishments on their slaves for the most trivial offences.
Darby was catched eating canes, had him well flogged and then rubbed in salt pickle, lime juice and bird pepper. Also whipped Hector for losing his hoe, made new Negro Joe piss in his eyes and mouth.
Such treatment provoked frequent slave rebellions.
Saturday, the 7th of June, 1760, was alarmed in the night by a canoe coming up the trench, but made them stop when about halfway up by threatening to fire at them.
In that year's rebellion, the slaves planned to take over the estates entirely.
Mr. Weech says he's afraid of being murdered in the woods. We're in the most imminent danger. All the Negroes in the island, it is said, were to have rose at Whitsuntide, but by mistake, Negroes in St. Mary's rose at Easter. Fire was to have been set to the towns in many places at once, and all the whites who came to extinguish them were to be murdered in the confusion whilst the estate Negroes engaged their overseers.
Suddenly, no slave could be trusted.
A general inclination to revolt appearing among all the Negroes, it was thought necessary to make a few terrible examples of some of the most guilty. Of the three found guilty of killing the whites on Ballard's Valley, one was condemned to be burnt, the other two to be hung up alive in irons and left to perish in that dreadful situation. The wretch that was burnt was made to sit on the ground, and his body being chained to an iron stake, the fire was applied to his feet. He uttered not a groan and saw his legs reduced to ashes with the utmost firmness and composure, after which one of his arms, by some means getting loose, he snatched a brand from the fire that was consuming him and flung it in the face of his executioner.
By the 1770s, Thistlewood owned a modest estate with some high-quality livestock. He had become a member of the Jamaican landed gentry, Justice of the Peace, and Lieutenant of Savannah Lamar. He made the independent-minded Fibber his slave wife, and despite his infidelities, she lived with him until his death.
Friday, 1st March, p.m., cum Fibber. Thursday, p.m., cum Fibber. She gave me a gold ring to keep for her sake.
She also gave him a son, whom he recognized as his own. In his will, he arranged for his property to be sold and the money used to buy Fibber her freedom and build her a house. The settlers and slaves alike were beset by natural disasters. In 1786, the year Thistlewood died, the fifth hurricane in 6 years almost destroyed everything he'd built up.
Monday, 2nd October, 1780. My dwelling house began to go, and about sunset, a little before six, the wind coming to the south, being at its height, and raging with the utmost violence and irresistible fury, tore in pieces the remainder of my house, dispersing it in different ways. Many of my sheep are dead or dying, the external face of the earth so much altered I scarce know where I am. Mr. Woodbine says there perished in the hurricane of the bay about 70 whites.
That diary was written evidence of scars on the West Indian soul. Kind or cruel, the whites themselves were corrupted by slavery. Humans became more expendable than machines. At times, slave mortality was so high that three slaves had to be imported for every one that was needed. The sugar plantocracies lived in so-called great houses and ruled with arbitrary power. The mistress of the splendid Rose Hall, Annie Palmer, was so cruel that her slaves eventually rebelled and murdered her. But she also took slaves as lovers, crossing the socially forbidden line into that black and white world known as Creole, where you find the unofficial legacy of the British in the Caribbean. You can find these stony reminders of the days of empire overlooking squares all around the Caribbean. But how much of Britain is there beneath the surface, in the people themselves? To look for that, you have to go to an island that was under Britain for longer than any other.
the place they call Little England. Barbados. Even the way people wait at the traffic lights seem to reflect a deeply internalized English sense of order. The street names have an incongruous grandeur alongside the chattel houses in which the poor still live. Everything, the towns, the parishes, the institutions, echo a world 4,000 miles away.
Near one of the old sugar mills is St. Nicholas Abbey, which is still lived in by a descendant of the English family who've owned it since slavery. A visitor observed, the planters ate like cormorants and drank like porpoises. One menu included suckling pig, loin of veal, goat, a leg of pork, three ducklings and three turtle doves. The Cave family has owned the house for five generations.
When I first got to know about it, my grandfather owned it and I was a boy. I didn't really quite understand much about it. I thought at one stage he owned all of Barbados, but I discovered later on it wasn't his, that he owned a little bit of Barbados. But I had a map of the world and I put his initials against Barbados. And when he died, I put my father's initials against it. And so one day for a laugh, when it became mine, I put my initials against it. And now, today, I'm the owner of a small part of Barbados, a very, very beautiful part of a very beautiful island.
Colonel Cave settled here permanently when he retired from the British Army in 1970. He leads a bachelor life with three-day-old copies of The Times and the BBC World Service for company. His grandfather dressed his large domestic staff in starched uniforms. The British simply transplanted to the tropics wholesale the etiquette, habits, and corsetry of upper-class England. That's all over now.
Cat always comes up for some milk. And they all know what time I come in, and they all come around. And in that way, we serve them. And now I can serve you a cup of tea. I've got a very nice lady who comes in every day and does a bit of cooking called Gloria. And I always forget to tell her what to produce for supper. So I end up by having to cook my own supper in the end. It's usually something pretty simple. Potatoes and vegetables, perhaps off the plantation, and some yams and a bit of chicken or something, very simple. But I'm a very bad cook, really.
To make ends meet, Stephen Cave now offers tourists a trip around the house with an ironic commentary on his ancestors' lifestyle.
Here you see a chair. This chair was made in London in about 1934. By a firm called Foot and Sons. You get in the chair in the morning and they come along and serve you your breakfast, and you have a good hearty breakfast there, and after breakfast the newspaper arrives. So it's hard work in the heat of Barbados, you know, holding the newspaper, so it's a good thing if you have it up like that, and there you can read the newspaper.
It would have been done 300 years ago. A horse being led for the very building by now sitting in. And that's my father about to get on the horse.
It's strange to watch the descendants of slaves listening to this son of the plantocracy describing the lives of their great-grandparents.
And everybody drinks rum punches here in Barbados, and he likes his rum punch. But he's got a problem, and you'll notice, you see, that when he's got his elbow there, he can't reach the rum punch. And it's hard work moving his hand like that with a rum punch in the heat of Barbados. So what you need to do is to put it in the right place. But you see, when he's got it up here, it's still not quite right, so we put it there, and then we have to raise it up a little bit and lock it there, and then he has the rum punch where he wants it. We have a photocopy here of a valuation of the plantation in 1822 when old Mr. Cumberbatch died. It's a sad document because it shows the names of all the slaves here on the plantation, listed under the men, the women, the boys, and the girls. There's one here called Kitty Grace. She's worth £120, and she would have been about 20 years old. And then after lunch, of course, the only thing to do is he goes down for the afternoon and has a good sleep.
But gentility indoors hid some harsh realities outside.
They started to introduce steam engines. You had to be very careful not to put your hand inside, because if you put your hand between there, your hand would go in and you wouldn't be able to get it out. And if you weren't quick, you'd go right through it yourself. And so they used to keep an old machete here, and the other man would be ready, and he'd cut your hand off if he was quick enough and save your life. Risky business.
Many sugar estates have now abandoned production, and to Stephen Cave's dismay, the Barbadian government has threatened to nationalise the rest.
If they told me that they were managing the plantation and I couldn't manage it, I think I'd give them a pretty difficult time, really. The property has survived as a plantation entirely through my determination to keep it going. I enjoy running this plantation enormously, and I have no desire to do anything else. I'm nearly 60 now, and I hope to go on working on the plantation for as long as I possibly can. And then, as far as I'm concerned, they can bury me on the plantation and make the canes grow a bit better.
This house is also a legacy of the British settlement in Barbados. It's tempting nowadays to think of the British Caribbean as divided, roughly, between the descendants of those people on top, the planters, and those at the bottom, the slaves. But it was never as simple as that. The expanding sugar industry pulled in another class of settlers, the much despised and often desperately poor, poor whites. You can still see their descendants right here in Barbados. The ancestors of these redlegs, as Barbadians called them, were indentured workers, men and women press-ganged into service in Britain, or the Catholic prisoners of Oliver Cromwell's grand Irish and Scottish campaigns. Others were discharged soldiers and convicts trapped in the Caribbean beyond the reach of the law. The majority of these people were men and women who, through force of circumstances, had signed away their liberties as surely as the slaves had been deprived of theirs. Today, generations later, some of them are rich. Others are still poor, like people who live around here. But all of them would say that they're just as Bajan as any black person. This is the home of a descendant of one of those poor white families, Richard Goddard. The Goddards are now among the rich of the island, but only two generations back, they were typical redlegs. Now, everyone knows the Goddards. They're prominent among the small number of poor whites who have made it into middle-class society through success in business. The family owns supermarkets, a bakery, an airline catering firm, a rum company, and a meat processing plant. Richard Goddard himself is a far cry from the old white planters. He considers himself completely Barbadian. The business grosses over £65 million a year and employs 1,600 workers.
That's right. Thank you. Bye-bye.
And they owe it all to this one remarkable man.
This photograph was taken about 1900 in Bath, St. John, Barbados. And it's the earliest photograph I can find of a member of my family, Thomas Henry Goddard. They're all fishermen, both black and white. And you can see it was great poverty among them. They're wearing just jute bags, sacks, with the head cut out and shoulders. And they're smoking a clay pipe. My grandfather, he left the parish in 1890 and walked to town with nothing. And he got a job in what they call the ruins, the burnt area of Bridgetown. And he was working for 60 cents for 60 hour a week, 1 cent an hour.
Richard's grandfather rose each day at 3. He worked and saved enough to give his 7 children a good education. One of them, John Goddard, standing there on the left, captained the West Indies cricket team.
This photograph was taken in the mid-1950s. The families are dressed formally, my father on the left. You'll notice that in a space of 50-odd years, we have moved from sacks to tuxedos. And that's a great improvement.
This is the home of Richard Goddard's second cousin, Evelyn. I must admit I find it very odd to meet poor white people in a tropical country. In London, yes, but here it seems strange. Richard Goddard regularly visits his cousin and other relatives in the area. Livestock and poultry reared in the backyard is what many redlegs depend on for a livelihood. Traditionally, they keep themselves to themselves, intermarrying only with other poor whites, despising the blacks and despised by them in return.
I think she looks on me as a friend, as someone that she can come to with her problems or for advice. But there's been a respect on both sides. I realize that she is a humble person and she's a person who has worked hard and a very happy person.
Happy husband. Hey, how are you? Nice to see you.
Yeah,
how are you keeping?
I'm keeping fine.
How are Rick?
Rick is right here.
You there?
She speaks a very strong Barbadian dialect. And I think that I understand her very well, and I myself would slip into that dialect very easily. It's a mixture of Scotch and Irish.
Evelyn is exceptional in having married a black man. Although the couple are poor, like many Barbadians, they have to protect themselves against thieves.
I've got two up on the bed, I've got three in there. One down kitchen, one up in that corner.
Well, you got more.
She explains that there's a machete ready behind every door.
Evelyn, how about your knee now? How are you? Have you had a bad knee?
No, let me tell you. This is what that I get.
There are real class differences between these cousins. You'll notice she always calls him Mr. Goddard.
Where are you sick that time?
Oh, love, the hair's all broken up, Mr. Goddard.
Mm-hmm.
Then he come and looked for me, man, he cried, but...
They feed you in the hospital?
They give me something there, but Mr. Goddard...
You can't cook like you?
No, I can't cook neither. Then they smelly fish, it's too raw.
Oh. It had a season in it.
Mm-mm. None at all.
No salt.
And I very salt.
They're an object lesson, these poor whites, in the dangers of stereotyping the British legacy in the Caribbean.
Henley! 100 rams on the bar, please.
The Barbados Yacht Club, on the other hand, conforms more to type. Ralph is the life and soul of the party. He belongs to those white families who are guardians of a certain colonial lifestyle and also of the island's purse strings. Although the club needs to attract more local members, so far only the waiters are black.
I think that I'm closer to an African than a European because I was brought up to be Barbadian. We learned to eat, party, quarrel, fight, even talk. All of our dialect is the same thing. So, I mean, without a doubt, I'm more Barbadian African than Barbadian European, without a doubt.
This was once the Royal Barbados Yacht Club with an exclusive white membership. A bastion of colonial power and privilege. Resident British officers were automatically honorary members. I wouldn't have been allowed through the gate. Ralph and his friends are anxious to convince you of how truly Barbadian they feel. Although everyone behaves as if they have no care in the world, to me they seem rather trapped, trying to sustain the tourist brochure, Bacardi ad view of their own island. Nowadays, blacks of the right class and income could become members, but they show little interest. I'm not surprised. Apart from the expense, echoes of the past still make us feel uncomfortable.
Racing glass and an excellent, a magnificent start, a well-sailed race. None other than green flash.
The club's image remains that of an enclave in which an exclusive white nouveau riche set sail, drink and party all weekend.
That sort of spirit of enjoyment, which is called Latin American or Caribbean, it's as much a part of me as the black people. I just gotta get home to see you again.
Blacks now hold political power, but the economy is still run from here, a compromise that suits both sides. During slavery, the Church of England was closely identified with the planter class. Unlike the Catholics in the Spanish islands, they didn't baptize slaves. Conveniently, perhaps, because it wouldn't have been right to mistreat a fellow Christian. But Christianity has been transformed by the encounter with Africa. Diane Sheldine's parents are poor, and the whole family has contributed to the cost of a proper wedding. She could be setting out for any church in England. But Diane is a member of a breakaway black church known as the Spiritual Baptists. Founded by His Lordship Bishop Glanville Williams in 1957, it's one of the fastest growing churches in the Caribbean, with over 180,000 members. The bishop's approach is a long way from the Church of England.
They have had so many visions, and too numerous to mention them. I have met Jesus. I have met many angels. We talked. I met Moses, I met Abraham, I've even seen Adam.
The prophetic language may seem out of key with the conventional idiom of Diane's dress, but it's a thread that goes right back to slavery. Black churches offered the one language in which slaves could express their dream of freedom and the promised land. And still today, spiritual baptism gives these people a dream beyond the poverty of their daily lives.
Yes, I have met many of the apostles and the prophets, Isaiah. I had a vision, I went to heaven. And I didn't know where it was, but I saw this being so tremendously big. And he came to me and told me, "We are going to take you to see the palace of the great king." I said, "This would be God." He said, "Yes, you will see where God live." I said, "Where God live or his throne?" He said, "No, where God live." So I was so happy. And a chariot came. This place was so beautiful, as far as my eyes could behold. The green, the pastures, they're alive, but not like our grass. You know, everything was so, the trees were different, but I mean, very unearthly. This beautiful place. I said, "Where is this?" An angel said to me, "This is the palace of the great king." And the chariot stopped. I heard a trumpet blow. Never heard anything like it. It could wake the very heavens. And like all inside of me want to come out. And they heard, "This is the chariot that God rides across the heavens in." And when I came back to the place, they said, "You will go back to the earth and tell your people what you saw." To my wedded husband.
To my wedded husband.
The revivalist churches which grew out of slavery had to borrow their forms of worship from their white masters. But they subverted them, transforming them into that unique fusion, Afro-Christianity.
To love and to cherish.
To love and cherish.
How staid and repetitive the Anglican ritual sounds in their midst.
They get weary of the same thing over and over, the same prayers over and over. They have not changed over those years, and I think people get tired of the same thing. When at the spiritual church, you hardly see the same thing in a year. And we take the most solemn hymns, even Abide With Me, and we make it rock and roll.
The planters described slaves who danced like this as lewd and lascivious. They didn't understand that once appropriated, religion became a site of cultural resistance. In this church, laborers and domestic servants become prince shepherds and daughters of Jerusalem.
Every individual must do something. So I think they like doing something in worship, and they want to know that they are counted. I think that's it. And then everybody has a chance to testify. Nobody testifies in the Anglican Church. I think the people want, they want to get out of something. They're not only one man knows about God. Everybody want to feel him.
If religion is one escape route, another is education.
This really reminds me of my school days. This is Harrison College, but I went to a college very much like this in Jamaica in the 1940s and 50s. The British established these sorts of schools everywhere they went in the Caribbean. They offered a very good, very academic, but very conventional and very British education. I sweated in classrooms like these over Latin conjugations and words with daffodils. I learned very little about Jamaican plants and flowers or about the Atlantic slave trade. These schools were modeled on the English public school. We had prayers in chapel. We had a tuck shop. We wore caps and blazers even in the fiercest summer heat.
Harrison College was originally a charity school for poor white boys. Now it educates all classes and colors, provided they're clever enough. Professor Rex Nettleford is a beneficiary of that English colonial education, as well as an acute observer of its ambiguous legacy.
Many of us have lived long enough to appreciate the inheritance of law, English law, sense of fair play, parliamentary democracy, political order, good sportsmanship, that kind of thing.
And of course, the club.
The number of administrators who were here at Naturally would want to have a club. Thank you so much. Want to have a place for recreation. Of course, the senior common room in the university, which is patterned on Oxbridge or the London University, has very much the same phenomenon. And people away from home would naturally want to have a little bit of home away from home. And this is what it represents. I'm afraid many of us colonials took it rather seriously and saw it as something that went with the status. But I presume snobbery is to be found, and snobbishness in all peoples of all races, and they manifest this in different fashion. But let's say, even if we had a natural inclination for this, it was reinforced by the example set by the British overlords.
When Rex and I were schoolboys, this club, the Ligonie in Kingston, Jamaica, was reserved for whites and a few token coloureds.
Basically trying to court disaster.
After independence, a black manager was hired to revive its fortunes. 75% of the members are black now, well-off, cosmopolitan, a new elite. But Britishness lives on. The menu, chips with everything, remains virtually unchanged.
What's happening in Cayman? I hear you're Cayman. Off. Yes, I hear you're off.
Although being white doesn't cut much ice, being affluent and middle class does.
This is an inheritance, undoubtedly. There are other kinds of inheritances. The club is a British inheritance.
Cricket is another one. But cricket belongs to everybody. In fact, it's a sort of secular religion, which can also provide an escape route from poverty.
What did you do? How did you get up?
Caught behind.
Caught behind, yeah.
In Barbados, being one of the greatest fast bowlers of all time has helped Wes Hall to become a senator and a minister for sport. His terrifying pace attack during the 1966 Test Series in Australia astounded the Brisbane crowds and changed attitudes at home. Until the 1960s, the West Indian team was always captained by a local white. But the impact of world-class players like these allowed blacks to claim the game for themselves.
There was a time, of course, when in the West Indies cricket, we were thought as calypso cricketers. People used to think we used to have a good time, you know, sing calypsos and drink rum, really. But those days are long past. The team is now a most cohesive force. And I would say that they're very professional, about the most professional unit in world cricket, the West Indies team. From the time a boy in the West Indies is at school, he plays cricket. He plays it on the beach, he plays it in the road, he plays it in the little gaps, he plays it on the playing fields. It doesn't really matter. As soon as a West Indian boy can walk, he wants to play. We are very enthusiastic in what we do. Our crowds are, you know, vociferous. They know the game inside out. And it doesn't matter where you come from or, you know, color, class or creed in the Caribbean, you can play for the West Indies.
Though Wes is too polite to say so, the sweetest win is still beating the old colonizers at their own game.
My philosophy in life really is things like hate and animosity. I tend to block them out of my mind. I've learned that a long time ago. And therefore, I don't think it's worthwhile for me to go around not liking the English.
People like Wes Hall can afford to be magnanimous. For most young Barbadians, he's a shining example of what cricket offers. A route to foreign travel, a professional career, and a lot of status. But a new generation have their eyes fixed on a different horizon.
My only problem, I don't have anything.
Wes Hall's daughter, Kerry, belongs to that fashion-conscious middle-class crowd who shop abroad and prefer Miami styles to London's.
But, you know, looks like you anyway. Thank you.
The change across just three generations is dramatic.
Personally, I take control as far as his dressing is concerned. And in recent years, he has gotten a lot more. He's come a long way and gotten a lot more trendy. Before, he didn't really, you know, he was very easygoing. But now he is in the mirror. You sure this looks good? You know, should I wear this tie with this? And he's very fashion conscious all of a sudden. And I think I take credit for that completely. Can I have this month?
Well, I
when Wes was a boy, his mother kept a small shop. Now the family exudes a kind of mid-Atlantic confidence.
I think that we're going to get big weight, and I'd like you to come and lead me.
Wes owns racehorses, while his daughter updates his rather English conservative tastes.
When I saw the punk hair, I told her that she probably has to go live somewhere else. You know, I thought it was strange to me. And then it grew on me, and as a matter of fact, I began to like it, and indeed I do now, and except if she cuts it too short, I then say, gee, you need to get that thing grown.
The differences between father and daughter symbolize the deeper shift in middle-class attitudes. British definitions of success, status, and respectability are old hat. Kerry judges success by American standards. Among the older generation, the British connection is still remarkably strong. Today is the 350th anniversary of the Barbados Parliament. Like other British islands, Barbados has retained much of its British ritual intact and inappropriate as ever. Real democracy has a shorter history here. There's a black governor now, but until the 60s, a succession of white governors representing the crown governed Barbados, often with scant knowledge of its people. When London imposed the emancipation of slaves in 1834, this assembly regarded it as unwarrantable interference.
We must look beyond the fact that our parliament was created in 1639 for the exclusive use of the plantocracy against monarchical power.
The leader of the opposition, the wealthy British-trained lawyer, Henry Ford.
Those of us who are in my age group, who are in our 40s, 50s, and who have been trained in Britain, do have that recognizable attachment to Britain and British institutions and British ideas. But the younger generation, my son, for instance, of who's now in his early 20s, although he's studying Britain, he does not show that same reverence and love. He's mostly oriented towards the North America and North American system. And that's again because the British flag has been withdrawn and the British influence is waning.
Henry Ford reminds me of Gandhi's remark that once the British left India, people would start to be nostalgic for their return.
I think Britain has reneged within the Commonwealth on its duty to maintain its own traditions, its own culture, and its own influence. I regretted very much, for instance, the removal of the privileges, if you will call them that, given to Commonwealth citizens to come into British institutions of learning. Now today, my son, if you send your son to study overseas, I have my son in Hull, for instance, he has to pay much more than someone, let us say, coming from Luxembourg or Greece or Spain, because he's not within the European common market. And that's a deterrent. Once before, we would be happy to send children to public school in England, those people who could afford it. Now, instead, most parents will send them to public school in Canada. And in a way, it tells against Britain eventually in economic and trading terms.
These distinguished-looking men probably drive American and Japanese cars, send their children to study in Canada, and their wives to shop in New York. But 30 years after independence, they're still sweating it out in incongruous English-style wigs, in absurd mimicry of an England which hardly exists anywhere, except perhaps as a country of the mind.
I think it would be a good thing if Britain realized that it has a tremendous asset and legacy that it should not squander so easily.
Coming rapidly into view these days is a different sort of black. These are confident young men, their sexual and other skills constantly on display to admiring tourists. No British role models here. How things have changed since Thomas Thistlewood jotted down his sexual exploits in dog-eared Latin. The ritual at my old school, Jamaica College, hasn't changed much. But here too, there's something different underneath. These are the children of independence. Unlike me, they've never lived under direct colonial rule. I asked a group of sixth formers what they thought about the British legacy.
I think one very important thing that the British has left us is that we have, as a people, have learned to pull ourselves out of any bad situation that we are in. Without their oppression, we would not have learned that, you know, we are a strong people.
A lot of people think that the British are very pompous and arrogant because they've imprinted a certain mentality that whites are better than blacks, you know. They can fulfill certain positions, maybe better than a black person. And as a foreigner, they can do certain jobs better.
I think that after independence, the British sort of abandoned us because as our former mother country, I think that it should be one of their duties to see to it that we were off on our feet. Right? And they just sort of left us there economically to strive for ourselves.
The British have left us our way of thinking, our parliamentary system, our legal system. The British have also left a negative impact on our society. And it was during British colonization of our country that we see that many of the people developed this kind of slave mentality. We often hear Bob Marley talking about emancipate yourself from mental slavery. Now, this is a thing which is affecting our society today, where many of us feel that to do certain jobs is to actually commit yourself to slavery.
When the British came, they tried to suppress our culture. They didn't understand it. But what that created was sort of a blend. So the blend is between some African culture, some British, and some West Indian culture. And that, in turn, spawned what is now our modern West Indian culture. So although we might not want to acknowledge it, we have to admit that the British have played a role in our culture. But of course, it could have been better without them. Yeah.
Crop over is when sugar workers traditionally celebrated the end of their labors in the cane field. It's an obligatory occasion for white Barbadians too, but its revival as a festival owes something to the development of black consciousness in the 70s, its continuity and change in one event. Margaret Goddard arrives in the same cart that used to take the water to the black cane cutters in the fields.
This country may be blessed as we bring this Thanksgiving ceremony to mark the opening of this wonderful crop over.
But it's the spiritual Baptist leader, Bishop Williams, who has devised the ceremony. Descendants of master and slave look on as the nightmare of the past becomes the spectacle of the present. And it all takes place at St. Nicholas Abbey, where Stephen Cave, the plantation owner, is a bystander at his own feast. The dancing mimics those past occasions when, briefly, the worlds of master and slave were allowed to meet. Today, both in body and spirit, the old plantation gang seems to have taken over.
For the people in the English-speaking Caribbean, it is very important to remember that we are all the creatures of colonialism, that our own self-realization is coming through or has been forged in the crucible of the colonial experience.
The story of the British in the Caribbean is an unfinished love-hate affair. The colonizers have gone, but one still feels their brooding presence. Their way of life has left an indelible mark. But everyone knows that they came as enslavers and live like lords of humankind. And the iron of that experience has entered the soul. One day, West Indians may learn to forgive, but they're unlikely to forget. What they have learned to do is survive. They've come through to the other side.
Just the sheer excitement of being alive in this part of the world at the moment is that one feels a sense of being in formation, that one feels that one is at the beginning of something and that one is participating in creating a persona. And this is exciting.